Magazine. I'm your brother and host, Kareem Alar. I hope you enjoyed the program last week. And surprisingly enough, there are still people in the Piedmont Triad who did not know that Winston-Salem was the first city to desegregate lunch counters in the South. And also, hats off to Mr. Carl Matthews for not accepting money to prolong this movement, because violence did occur in other cities and there was injury to human beings. However, in the city of Winston-Salem, there was no violence. No one was injured. No one was bitten by a dog. No one was hit over the head with a club by some police officer. No water hoses were used against the people here in the city of Winston-Salem, as it took place in other cities where the sit-in demonstrations occurred. But as I said, history out of all our studies is most rewarding. Winston-Salem was the role model, as Gandhi was the role model to Martin Luther King and his idea of what we call peaceful protest. Although it did turn violent sometimes, but Gandhi was the role model. Anyway, today's program is about a pioneer, a black pioneer, in the field of preaching Christianity to the so-called American Negro here in the United States of America. I know today we have many, many black preachers of Christianity that are very successful and have large congregations and are really examples of what they call the mega church, the big church. We got Creflo Dollar Ministries. It's one of the biggest ones. We have Eddie Long out of Atlanta, Georgia. We got T.D. Jakes out of Dallas, Texas. Casey Price out there in Los Angeles, California. And you have had so many today. But yesterday, there were a lot of pioneers doing the same thing. And I know some of you may not remember the brother named Reverend Ike. He had a large congregation. But the history today is about a brother who I think all of you all remember, and maybe some of you younger people may not know who I'm talking about, but this man was from Concord, North Carolina. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to take a commercial break, and then we'll come back, and I'm going to introduce you to this man. So don't touch that dial. We'll be right back.
Piedmont Triad, rooms for rent.
Where we got quality name brand product.
Always with 100% satisfaction guarantee. Why go anywhere else when we got what you need?
Rooms for rent.
Eat healthy, my friends. Visit Forsyth Seafood Market and Grill, the best you ever tasted. Hot, delicious seafood from the grill, fresh seafood daily from the market, located on the corner of 1st and Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, Winston-Salem, North Carolina.
For the sophisticated woman with unique taste in clothing and accessories, and with an international flair, Lady Marion's Wearable Art, 319 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard, Greensboro, North Carolina, a global shopping experience. Vive la différence. If you haven't heard, it's the spoken word, open mic night at Basket Doodle. Basket Doodle specializes in gift baskets, homemade pastries, teas, coffees, and wine smoothies. Located 317 Martin Luther King Jr. Boulevard, Greensboro, North Carolina.
Become self-employed. Become a barber. Are you tired of looking for work? Well, enroll today at the Pyramid Institute of Barbering, founded in 1976 by Mr. Ganeen Fakan. Brand new location, brand new equipment in the North Chase Shopping Center, Winston-Salem, North Carolina, 5029 University Parkway. Call today, 336-744-3698.
Sure, all over the country we have these black preachers of Christianity who are amassing enormous amounts of wealth. But when did all this begin? Well, it just didn't start yesterday. So this month in Black History, I'm going to acquaint you with a man who was doing his thing back in the 30s. And he's originally from Gastonia, North Carolina. His name was Charles Emmanuel Grace. Now, the reference I'm using for the information about Charles Emmanuel Grace is out of an Ebony magazine dated 1952. As you see there, this is a collector's item. I'm going to tell you why it's a collector's item. Because right down there at the bottom where you see my finger, it's just listed the month, January, and not the year. And I don't know how many copies they printed like that year, but most of them, after this publication, it was February, and underneath the bottom of February, you saw the year 1952. But this was an article printed in 1952 in the January issue of Ebony Magazine. The title of the article is America's Richest Negro Minister. Now, let's pay attention. Daddy Grace, that was his name. It says, Daddy Grace heads religious empire worth $10 million. The founder of the colorful cult claims to be Portuguese. He tells his followers that he is not a Negro, and that what they see is the earthly reincarnation of a prophet of God. He says that he decided to lead Negroes because they were underprivileged, oppressed, and needed help. He says, I am a colorless man. Sometimes I am black, sometimes I am white. There's an exotic air about this stately brown-skinned man with a paunch and a frolicsome sense of humor. There's a foreign flavor about him from his accent to his gestures. He enjoys being feted and photographed and is unrivaled at the art of making the most of the spotlight. In material terms, he's probably the nation's most powerful religious leader of color. Though his personal holdings are apparently small, he controls the far-flung properties and cash that are owned in the name of various local churches. He plans all the investments, regulates all the spending, decides what properties will be purchased and when. He is the undisputed boss of the House of Prayer financially as well as spiritually. He says, I know what's best for my children. I make decisions. They obey me because they know I am always right in such matters. I use the money to help my children. You know, years ago, when I was growing up as a young man, I used to hear people say that one of Daddy Grace's favorite sayings was, put paper in the cup because the sound of metal hurts my ears. Finances is the bedrock of Daddy Grace's church, and the ritual makes it plain that raising money is the most important item on a prayer meeting's agenda. They place a powerful emphasis on money and means of persuading the brethren to make contributions. Giving to Daddy is a spiritual obligation of the church from which followers derive a strange, sometimes ecstatic, delight. Giving to Daddy is a spiritual obligation of the church from which followers derive a strange, sometimes ecstatic, delight. The laws of the church centralize the flow of finances to Daddy Grace himself. One law states no pastor is to handle money. Another law, each house must have a banking committee and a committee to pay bills, unless there is a written order from Daddy Grace to do otherwise. Another law requires that pastors must be in the knowledge of everything, every penny raised and spent. And another law says that all pastors must see to it that each member pays his convocation fee and substantial rallies put on for the upbuilding of the kingdom of heaven, and this is to be put in the hands of our general builder to build as he sees fits without bounds. Daddy Grace. Now, you know, he is often charged with being the dictator of his church and with manipulating its funds to his own personal advantage. Daddy Grace has taken many steps to refute those allegations. He was once disturbed by reports that he personally owned apartment buildings in New York and other cities. 4 years ago, and this is talking about 1952, so this was in 48, he registered the buildings in the name of the House of Prayer for All People. This was a costly move since it meant that the church would pay considerably more in income taxes on profits earned by the buildings. Now, I'm just going to show you two pictures of the buildings on the screen there. I want you to take a good look at them. The first one is the famous 555 Edgecombe Avenue building, apartment house on Sugar Hill in New York City. Daddy Grace acquired this building in 1947. The price was $1,800,000. All that lived in the building was white folks. There were no black people that lived in the building. There was another 10-story Riverside Drive building, which was more or less a business, offices, that he purchased for $190,000 in New York City. All the tenants in that building were white people. And then there was another Riverside Drive property in New York City, which was an 82-unit, 9-story apartment building that covered an entire block at a cost of $700,000 in 1944. All the tenants in that building were white people. Now, in the year 1950, the sisters got together in Baltimore, and I want you to watch that on the screen, and they built a well, okay, an artificial well, and covered it with dollar bills, approximately $150,000 was on this artificial well. The bucket inside the well was filled with money. As you see the picture, Daddy Grace, when he goes into the well, he displays bills from the greenback covered bucket in the money covered well. He raises fabulous sums, several millions, and claims that the money is for the uplift of his children. So you see, let's go to another shot. Here's Daddy Grace, he's reclining in a comfortable chair on his throne, and there he is sitting in the back of his Cadillac. Now, the Cadillac drive, the limousine, he goes from city to city. His personal fleet included 7 cars, 5 Packards, all 7 cars totaling $35,000 in value. Now, you know, $35,000 in value today would be something like maybe $350,000 or more in automobiles. Okay. Now, Daddy Grace Charles Emmanuel Grace, born in Gastonia, North Carolina. Now, going up on the screen now is another business building that he purchased for $800,000 in 1947, which is on the corner of 8th Avenue and 125th Street in New York City. Okay? Daddy Grace evicted Metropolitan Life Insurance Company out of this building because he said they were acting biasly toward Negroes. He evicted Metropolitan Life Insurance Company out of that building, the top of that building, because they were biasly treating Negroes. Now, right up under that picture is a picture of his home in Havana, Cuba, which he bought in 1936. It was a flower-bedecked palace that covered 22 acres and was built by a former senator of Cuba for $100,000 at government expense. Daddy Grace purchased this house in 1936. The origins of Daddy Grace are obscure. He says he was born in Portugal and is a citizen of the world. At other times, he declares his loyalty to the United States, proclaiming patriotically, "I am an American." Some say that he was born in the West Indies, but those who know him well say that Gastonia, North Carolina, is his real. I think you still have a couple of churches left. I think it's one in Greensboro, United House of Prayer for All People. They have a very nice restaurant in the basement of that building. But here's a brother from Concord, North Carolina, that was accumulating wealth and collecting money with his idea of preaching in the 20th century. So I hope people learn something today, but he was one of the pioneers. This is my comment about all of this. In my book, I state that we as a people, black people, we have more churches, more denominations, more prophets, more prophetesses, more bishops, more people claiming to have talked with God and met with God and heard from God and have the best solution to help all of us black people here in America than anybody else that's here in America. Yet we make up 12 to 13% of the population in the United States of America, but we make up over 70% of the imprisoned population in America. We make up the majority of the unemployed people in America. We make up the majority of the poorest people here in America. We make the majority of people who are high school dropouts in America. We have the worst picture in America, but yet we are the people who have more prophets, more prophetesses, more preachers, more denominations, and more churches than any other people in America.
What issues surround integration in the new millennium? Are they the same as in years past? Racism continues to prevail. Integration, Has It Been Progress or Regret? By Kareem Allah. A little book with a lot of light. Order your copy today.
Well, now, here's the question. Is this a business? Is this a business? Is the idea of preaching Christianity to the masses of black people a business? Because it certainly is a good business.
What issues surround integration in the new millennium? Are they the same as in years past? Racism continues to prevail. Integration, Has It Been Progress or Regret? By Kareem Allah. A little book with a lot of light. Order your copy today.
Give your business a boost, more exposure. Advertise on AAP Magazine. Reach the multitude of viewers in the 7-county area of the Piedmont Triad. Call today for ad rates. You'll be glad you did. 336-749-0355.
What are people attracted to? Well, it appears to me that if, and just speaking in terms of black people, we have been eating the bread of affliction for the last 457 years. And so we have a natural attraction to scraps. We have a natural attraction to leftovers. You know, in Matthew it says that's why the eagles gathered where the carcass was. Because the carcass, they didn't want nothing but scraps. They didn't want any information that would have eliminated their procrastination. Because everybody knows what needs to be done, but everybody is not willing to do it. This has been a fact for the last 75, 80, 90, 100 years. We all know that God bless the child got his own, but we just don't want to go in that direction of getting our own. Because for some reason, we believe that that might be a curse. Maybe, I don't know. But I do know this. What could be done one of these days will not be done at all. And if you won't do better today, you will certainly do worse tomorrow. This is what we bear witness to today. So, in learning something about the history and the pioneers and seeing how, as some of our people say, it's the same old soup, it's just warmed over. I want to add something to that. It is a plate of scraps, but the waiter just garnishes it differently. And the people gather wherever they like the waiter and the way he garnishes the plate. I hope everybody enjoyed the program today. I hope you learned something. And I will be getting back with you next week.